What do you carry when you fly to know your speed and height and location? I'm going to take you in a bit of a potted history of the gadgets I've used over the years before introducing you to the one instrument I fly with today. I'm going to show you in action in flight, and I'm going to tell you what you'll need if you want to use it yourself. When I started flying paramotors 13 years ago, I tried to combine it with my love of gadgets. It was 2006 and options were pretty limited for that sort of info. GPS was pretty new and smartphones didn't exist. So I started out with two instruments. A big old paragliding Vario I'd had since I learned to paraglide 4 or 5 years before. And a cutting edge, for the time, PDA that had built in GPS. Now, there was a program on this you could run, GPS Dash it was called. And you could get your speed and height as you flew. I still needed the Vario as a backup because this thing ran Windows and crashed all the time. And the Vario, of course, was only as good as the height calibration that you'd done before you took off. And while it did tell me my location as coordinates, that wasn't a lot of use, frankly. And it did have a waypoint feature, but it was so much hassle to use that flight that you just never used it. Now over the next few years, stuff like the Garmin GPSs started to come out with moving maps, but they were pretty basic and they were very expensive and they didn't really cater for the sort of stuff that you want to know when you're flying. They were more for like walkers and climbers. It was 2011-2012 before that changed with the iVariometer app for the iPhone 4 and then the PPGPS app for Android. And there's no doubt about it, these apps were great. Finally you could get all the info you needed for flying. But it did require you to have a phone and some sort of flight deck to put it on, and you had to worry about battery life because the screen's on all the time. It can also be quite difficult to see the phone screen outside in bright sunlight. And if you have operations to do on that phone, that can be a pain as well. You have to take your gloves off or poke about with a stylus. For me, cool as they were, my gadget love while flying had kind of worn off. These apps had taught me the kind of info I need for flying. And it was a small subset of what these apps did. I felt I wanted to get back to basics, something that was an easy to use, reliable instrument, and ideally that didn't need to be mounted on a flight deck, so that I didn't need to fly with a flight deck all the time. So I made it my goal to try and make something that would give me the info I needed while eliminating all those drawbacks I've mentioned. My first attempt in 2012 was this. It's a micro LCD screen that I've sort of cobbled together, combined with GoPro that you feed into it, a GPS chip, all rigged up into an on-screen display. It's the sort of thing that RC flyers were starting to use, but I've combined it with this little screen. Mounting this on my helmet gave me a HUD, a head-up display. In keeping with the stupid names I give my inventions, I christened this StuHUD Mark 1. Now, it's difficult to show what using this is like. The best thing I can do is kind of simulate it. So basically, if you imagine that what you're seeing just now is what I'd be seeing, you see a little screen wherever you mount the thing. So I would have it usually down here, for example. You just sort of look down and you see a little television screen focusing in the distance. So there's no eye strain. And on it, I can see that I'm videoing from a GoPro and I can see my speed and my altitude and even the distance from home and direction all superimposed on the video. I powered up my batteries, I fitted in my helmet, so I didn't really need to worry about battery life much, and it was much easier to view in bright sunlight because, you know, this screen's all sort of inside. So I actually ticked a lot of the boxes that I was wanting. Obviously I looked a bit of a mad scientist, but it did work. So later, I made a Mark II, which was this guy. Way. So this used off-the-shelf HUD glasses that had just come out, but with the same electronics that I built before. And I used that for a brief period of time as well. Then what happened was a company called Recon came out with a HUD head-up display for skiing. This guy here. This was a lot more sophisticated. It's actually, I realized it was based on Android. And I realized if I bought one of these, I could write my own flying app for the first time. And I could actually make a flight instrument that did exactly what I wanted. So I built this in 2012, StuHUD Mark III. And it was bloody perfect for me at the time, to be honest. It had a clear screen where I can see my speed and my height and my direction, my distance from home, my direction to home, my distance flown, my flight time. And basically, it just was mounted on my helmet like this, and all I needed to do is look up to see. All I had to do was switch this on before a flight, and I had all the info I needed while flying. It was always there as it was built into the helmet, and the screen was visible just by looking up a bit. For me, it was great, but it was an expensive niche bit of kit. No one else had one, and at the time, the company didn't even have an app store that I could share the app with others with. Still, I used this for 3 years as my primary and secondary flight instrument. It was excellent. During that time, I also built this. It's based around a Kobo e-reader. It's hacked to run popular flying software, XCSOAR, and I've soldered a GPS chip into it. So this gives me a clear sunlight readable display because it's e-ink and a long, long battery life. So if I was flying with a flight deck, this was a great backup to the StuHud Mark III. And in fact, I still use this today if I'm flying with a flight deck. But for me, the game changer was when Garmin brought out their Fenix 3 smartwatch in 2015. Here was a device with a sunlight readable screen, a battery life that measured in weeks, not hours, and an always-on display, all unlike the existing Android and Apple watches that had just come out. It was, for me, a true smartwatch, in the sense it didn't even need a phone to work. It had a built-in GPS and a real barometer. Best of all, there was this promise of a software SDK, software development kit, that would allow people like me to write my own apps. So I bought one, and I loved it immediately. And I began writing my own app, Stufly. Yep, still using the stupid names, and used my experience of writing StuHud to make Stufly even better. To be honest, it came out just the way I hoped. I started flying with it in 2016, though it was about 18 months later before Garmin actually created a public app store and I could share the app with others on. So unlike StuHud Mark III, this is an app running on far more mainstream hardware. Lots more people have Fenix smartwatches. In fact, since this was launched in 2017 or so, about 2,000 people have downloaded it so far. I've kept updating it based on user requests, and I've tried to keep it compatible with the old watches, like my trusty old Fenix 3, as well as supporting as many of the new ones as I can. In fact, I just added Fenix 6S support last week. Finally, after a lot of blind alleys over the years, I've got my ideal flight instrument. And frankly, it's pretty much the only thing I fly with these days. Sure, if I have the flight deck with me because I'm taking my SLR up or whatever, I'll use the XCSOAR e-reader too, but 90% of my flights, I've every bit of info I need at the end of my wrist. So let's talk about what I need to know when I fly. So maybe it's the same stuff you need to know. If it is, I'll tell you later how you can get hold of Stufly for free. Here's a list of features I need, and therefore the ones that I built Stufly to provide. I need speed. I need altitude. I need my distance flown. I need the direction I'm flying. Now note, that's the direction I'm flying, not the direction my watch is pointing, okay? It's not like a compass. I want to be able to look at my app while I'm on the brakes, for example, and still know my direction. I want my time that I've been flying. I want the distance in a straight line to my takeoff point. I want the direction to get home. And I want it to be zero touch in flight. I don't want to have to be fiddling about with buttons and screens. And I'd like it to record my flight, give me a GPS track, where I went, what my altitude was, what my speed was. Also, over the years, based on user feedback, I've added some configuration options around the units used, etc., so they can be used in Europe and stuff. So for me, I check my NOTAMs before I fly, I check the airspace in the area that I'm flying, and usually that's sufficient to ensure that I don't go anywhere that I shouldn't. Stufly is not about providing hundreds of features like moving maps and airspace or other fancy stuff. If you really feel you need that kind of information when you're flying, you're going to have to look elsewhere. So let's give you a walkthrough of the app, then we'll go outside and have a flight. So to start Stufly, you just go to your apps and select it. Stufly then waits for a GPS lock. And we're running. The altitude shown is based on your Garmin config, so it's usually a mix of GPS and barometer for accuracy. On the left we have your current speed. The bottom two panels alternate. This one shows your distance home and the bearing to get home. The left one shows the distance flown and the time flown.
It only starts these counters once it detects you've taken off. At the top, we see your current bearing in degrees and the compass cardinal. The green arrow indicates direction, either absolute, so 180 degrees would be south, and it would be at the 6 o'clock position, or relative, which is what I prefer and what's shown here, where it stays at the 12 o'clock position. The red arrow shows the direction you need to turn to fly home. So here, in relative mode, it's showing that you need to turn 85 degrees right to be heading directly back to your takeoff field. Remember to start recording before you take off, and stop recording when you land. That will save a GPS track, which will then sync with the Garmin app on your phone. I'll show you that in a moment. Finally, there's a few configuration options. On the Fenix 3 version, you can disable the bottom panel, alternating readouts. The unit toggle allows you to change to metric meters and kilometers. The arrow toggle switches between the relative and absolute directions that I mentioned. And finally, you can zero your altitude before takeoff if you're one of the few people that find your altitude reading is offset for some reason.
Here's the Garmin Connect app on your phone that lets you browse your flights. Here's my last sky flight track. You can see it on the map with the headline stats. You can delve deeply into the details, and you can even see graphs of your speed and your ascents and descents through your flight. Okay, so some features are kind of impossible to show on the ground. So I tried to take some video of the watch in flight, and I'll explain at those points what the app's showing.
So you might be able to see that. It's just trying to get a GPS signal just now, which wouldn't take long. There you go. So now it's got a GPS signal. I'll just press the start button. So it's now recording. I'll stick this on. Winds a bit all over the place today. Not very, just coming in gusts. Again, it's one of these awkward takeoff times where you're waiting for the right wind direction.
Mostly it's been coming up, coming from that direction. Occasionally it's been coming the opposite direction. So we'll just wait for it to come up again. Come on, windy wind. Do your thing. Come on. I think we've got something coming in. I'm gonna get ready for it.
Just taken off. You can see the green arrow is showing straight ahead. The speed is showing 24 miles an hour. The altitude is about 790 feet. And we're climbing. I've been flying for about 2 minutes and I've travelled about a mile. And I'm about 0.9 miles from the takeoff field and a bearing of about 180 degrees. My current direction to take me back to the takeoff field. The red dot that's flashing is showing that I'm recording the flight. And at the bottom, time's displayed, but also you'll notice that's where the red arrow is. That's because it's telling me that my takeoff field is behind me at the moment. So let's start turning to the right, and you'll see the red arrow start to move around too. And you can see the takeoff field now, and see how the red arrow is pointing right to it. Every day is judgment day. Maybe somewhere down the road away, you think of me and wonder where. That's Chantry Park below, where Ed Sheeran was playing a few weeks ago. Down the road when somebody plays.
Well, it's all right.
glad to be here, happy to feel that. And it don't matter if you're by my side, I'm satisfied. Well, it's all.
On my way back now, you can see I've got the wind behind me. I'm making about 28 miles per hour. I'm just climbing to go over the town. So far I've done about 38 miles, but I'm only about 5.8 miles away from my takeoff field. And I've been flying for about 98-9 minutes, and I'm flying more or less directly back to the field. Since you can see that the red and green arrows are together.
So there you are, that was a nice flight. As you can see, I didn't have my gimbal fitted, so I mean, really, I was just there for a flight. It was a nice day and to demo the watch. So the footage I've got is fairly bumpy, I'm afraid, and frankly, that's the way it felt. You know, it was quite thermal. If you want to give Stufly a try, the good news is it's always been free and it always will be free. You can get it from Garmin's App Store, links in the description below. It comes in two versions, depending on the age of the Garmin device that you have. Make sure you get the right one. It's not compatible with every Garmin watch. Some have technical limitations, I'm afraid, the cheaper ones, and I'm afraid that just means supporting them is impossible. I've added support for every watch I can. I'm still working on support for the Fenix 6 and 6X that came out a couple of weeks ago. I have already supported the 6S, so if you've got a 6S already, you can download the app and it's supported. But I do realise these are expensive watches, you know, £400 to £600 or more. And frankly, my Fenix 3 is still great. It's chunky, and actually this chunky X size you need to pay more top money for these days for the big models. Running Stufly on it has exactly the same features as on the brand new Fenix 6. So if you want to get yourself one at eBay, there's tons of Fenix 3s for sale for around £100. They're all fully compatible with Stufly, so it doesn't need to break the bank. Anyway, thanks for watching as always. If you enjoyed this, please share it with your friends, like and subscribe. Until next time, I wish you light breezes and blue skies.